Hello and welcome to the Real Vision Daily Briefing. It's Friday, which means you're getting your weekly dose of the Daily Briefing. But did you know we film every single weekday for our Daily Briefing YouTube channel? If you like what you see here, click on the link in the description and subscribe to the Real Vision Daily Briefing and tune in to new episodes starting next Monday. We hope to see you there. On with the show. Bumble IPO, a sign of more hot initial public offerings to come, or a bubble indicator? U.S. Treasuries at yields of 1.2%. And of course, new developments in the crypto space. That and much more starts now. I'm Ash Bennington, joined by Ed Harrison and Jack Farley. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Good to talk to you, Ash.
Good to talk to you as well. Lots going on here. What's on your mind?
First and foremost is that IPO that you were talking about right at the top. I think it popped a lot. And I think your question about what is it a sign of, that's the question that's on everyone's mind right now.
Yeah. Is it starting to feel like we're partying like it's 1999, Ed? You were there?
It feels that way. I mean, maybe we're partying like it's 1998. But, you know, obviously in 98, we had the long-term capital management. But it definitely feels like it's open season for IPOs, not just SPACs. I mean, that's another thing that we can talk about later on. But certainly for companies that are not making any money to go public. In fact, actually, Joel Greenblatt and Howard Marks were talking about this in the interview that was released and that's on platform now. How it does seem like now we're in that season where if you're not profitable, hey, no problem. Money is there for the taking.
Yeah. So Ed, this is my question to you. And I also want to throw this open to Jack too. What is it that people really need to know here? You know, I think about this more broadly. I've been trying to struggle with this myself. And it's like, look, there's obviously an opportunity here in the sense that there are major changes that are happening. If you think about what Bumble is, we're in the middle of this pandemic. Everybody's in lockdown. People are striving for human connection. Everything is being digitized, virtualized. There's definitely an underlying trend here. However, there is also the question of valuations. Do things look rich? Do things look bubblicious? How do you try to contextualize that?
So Ash, I think that's a great question. I'm looking at this sort of going back to the GameStop thing that we were talking about 2 weeks ago. So this is a company, Bumble, that is trading at $80 a share. It had a huge spike. It was offered at $43 a share. Now it's at $80. And the question, just like with GME, is this something that's going to actually hurt retail investors? Because right. When you think about 1999, there was a bull market. I mean, if you look at the S&P 500, it was up 20% a year for every single year from 95 to 99. And so right at the end in 99, that was the end of a huge bull market. And the question then was, you know, who's getting into this market at the top and therefore getting hurt when the NASDAQ is down 80%, you know, when the S&P is down 30, 40%. That's what I'm concerned about right now. It's not that Bumble itself is overvalued or not. It's that the people who can least afford to get crushed if it is overvalued are the ones who are piling in right at this particular moment.
Yeah, really well said. Jack, what are your thoughts?
Well, Ed, I think that the conversation that you just were having about Bumble now reminds me of the conversation we had about Airbnb. When it went public in December, it more than doubled on its first day of trading, despite the fact that its ability to generate positive cash flow has not been substantiated. We're seeing the same thing with Bumble, but I want to turn the question both to the back of you. Does that really matter? Is the reason that companies don't have to be profitable anymore because interest rates are so low, so the discount valuations are being pumped up into the sky? Is it different this time? What do you guys think?
Well, I'll answer that from the Greenblatt and Mark's perspective. They were talking about that. People are struggling with that, especially because you're not using capital. In the old days, you know, basically you had to pour capital in and then you had to get a return. Now it's a different story. If you think about how they're talking about the story, it's different in terms of the capital investment. You do have to get these customers up front, get the network effects, et cetera. There might be something to be said for that accounting hasn't kept up with the way that businesses earn their money in terms of, you know, how do I spread the accounting over time in terms of the marketing in order to get a customer that's going to stay with me for 7 or 8 years. That's what Joel Greenblatt was saying. And I'd make a second point, which is that when you talk about Airbnb, and I go back to 1998, yeah, we have no idea where we are in this cycle, how much longer it can go on. The truth is that, you know, Yahoo IPO 96, we had other IPOs that were later. These things can happen over a longer period of time. If the market, if the economy is doing well, who's to say that we couldn't be here a year or two from now and there are 10 Bumble type IPOs that are happening and it's even better than it was before.
Yeah, you know, to pick up on Ed's metaphor from the 90s, look, the thing about Amazon, for example, there are two things that I think are important when you think about longer time horizons. The first is survivorship bias. How do you know that you're buying Amazon and not pets.com? That's a critical point. And the second point is that Amazon was underwater for years if you bought at the high in 99. And the reality is that there is a lot of risk in the system. But with that said, the flip side of it is also the opportunity, right? This sense that we are going through this period of digitization, virtualization, paradigm shifts, changes in consumer sentiment, changes in consumer buying patterns. And it really is kind of a wide open space in many ways. If you think about it, very often the incumbents have very difficult time shifting into new areas. If you think about Walmart in terms of logistics and the massive operation that they've had in place, Amazon somehow managed to beat them to the punch at every opportunity. Why is that? Incumbents, very difficult to interrupt themselves. So you have these opportunities where you have low base effects, opportunity to buy in at a relatively modest number relative to the potential total addressable market. But when you're making those kinds of decisions, there's a lot of risk. Ral said it last week. If you're coming to Real Vision for personal financial advice, you're coming to the wrong place. That's not what we do here. You have to understand your own individual objectives, risk tolerance, needs, risk capacity. These are all things that you really need to understand in order not to get hurt. And that's something that you can't get from analysis of markets. That's something that you need to talk to a professional about.
Yeah. So, Jack, where are you on this? I mean, because you weren't investing and partying back in 1999. This is your first bout with potential bubble. I mean, that's the content campaign that we're doing right now. How are you thinking about that? Is that even the right question?
Well, Ed, I agree with the comparison you made earlier to it being more like 1998, not just because we could have another year or another year and a half of speculative fervor before we get to some events, market events, but also because of long-term capital management. I think that's sort of what we saw with the massive forced degrossing of hedge funds over the past 3 weeks due to GameStop. Now that has largely exited the news cycle. I think that speculative frenzy has entered, it's found new homes in cannabis equities and random short squeezes that are scattered across the market that we can talk about. But I've got my eye on the credit markets because I feel like they are a little bit less rife with, I don't want to say speculation, but you know, in the equity markets, you have stocks going up 30% and then going down 30% a day. And these are not micro-cap stocks. But Ed, to get back to your broader point, I think some of the interviews that we've done on Real Vision with Russell Napier, Lynn Alden, your talk with Lynn Alden, and today's interview with Howard Marks and Joel Greenblatt seeks to answer that question from a variety of angles. And what I like about it is I think Joel Greenblatt and Howard Marks are two of the most well-respected interviews on the planet, but they're typically in the weeds. They're very micro. But in this interview that aired today on Real Vision, they sort of put on their macro hats and they really talked about how the Federal Reserve's actions in order to keep rates low, lower for longer, ultra low for ultra long, that really is such a game changer. And then so, you know, those micro investors, they put on their macro hats. Russell Napier, on the other hand, very a macro-oriented thinker, he put on his micro hat when he talked to Steve Clapham in Clapham. And he said, okay, what I believe, you know, is that inflation is coming and that it's coming in a big way. You know, I actually believe that deflation, I've been calling for deflation over the past decade and I've been dead right. Now I'm switching my view. So I think he's well-respected on that. And Steve Clapham brings him into the microsphere and says, hey, if inflation is coming, how can you invest? Obviously, we know gold does well in times of inflation. But let's say I'm not completely, you know, I want to hedge my bets and I don't want to completely go in all in on your thesis. How can I play that? So Ash, just to go back to what you said, again, it's Real Vision is not for specific, we don't give you specific trades. We don't really tell you to do anything. What we do is, you know, have on investors who explain their framework, and that helps the user build their frameworks, and then they can make their decisions that you know, coordinate with their own needs and that are in their own life. So,
well, yeah, we can do analysis of markets. It's the individual stuff that people really need to understand for their own risk tolerance, especially when there are, you know, so much apparent opportunity and also at the same time some things that appear to be structural risk rising. I'll give you an example that something that Ed sent me earlier in the day, an article about internalization of trades, the dark pools that are basically forming in those numbers. And I'm just going to read a couple of the numbers and then turn it over to Ed for his analysis on this. But right now, 47.2% of U.S. equity trading volume in January was executed outside public exchanges. And that's from 39.9% year over year. So a pretty significant jump here. And the peaks are above 50%. On peak days, high volume days, we're seeing 50% of the trade volume being executed off exchanges, internalized in dark pools. Ed, what's the significance of that, and why is it something that it caught your eye?
I think two points that I would make. One is about the exchanges themselves and the whole concept of DeFi and other sorts of things. I mean, what we're seeing now is an atomization of the structure of finance in general. You know, there's a more decentralized world that we're living in, and potentially this is one avenue that it's taking that we're seeing. The other thing is, if that is what's happening, and if it's happening specifically in this particular market, we have to think about regulation. And also, it goes back to what I was saying about the small guy getting hurt. I thought it was interesting. I don't know if you guys saw this, because I think I sent you the link from Carson Block. He had this article that he wrote in the FT, and he was basically saying, I think the article was labeled "The Stonk Bubble Poses Significant Global Risks." And I, you know, I put out three takeaways on Twitter to this. I mean, my takeaways were that zero rates and leverage together are dangerous. That's risk number one. Risk number two is a lack of regulation will lead to bad outcomes. That's exactly what I'm talking about with regard to what we're, you know, the dark pools thing. And then the third is that passive investing, this is what he said, and he name checked Mike Green specifically. Passive investing is an amplifying force in both directions, both up and down. So right now, passive is amplifying you up. But when the market goes down, as we saw it did in March, passive will amplify down. And, you know, Tyler Neville, he says this all the time. He's one of our friends here from RV who doesn't come on our platform as much. But he says, look, you know, when people stop investing in their 401ks, that's when you have to start worrying. It's when the passive flows stop going into the market. For me, that's when bad things are going to happen.
You know, Ed, we could do a 4-hour show about this, because this is an incredibly important point. When I was reading that article, you know, you obviously, the guys who do the internalization talk about fractionally better execution for retail traders. But here's the thing about market structure and liquidity. There's always a ton of liquidity when you don't need it. The question is, what happens when prices start moving? It reminds me in some ways of the artificial suppression of volatility with low interest rates. It's the forest fire metaphor. You clear out all of the underbrush, and maybe that doesn't have forest fires occur or spring up as often. But when they do, boy, do you really have a problem. It's an unknown effect. It's an unknown impact. I'm not trying to be gloom and doom or prophecy that there's going to be something massive that's coming. It's just hard to quantify. And now, by the way, we're getting less data around execution. We're getting less data around how orders get matched. Carson Block in the FT, a great article. I actually, it's funny, and I haven't had the opportunity yet to look at your Twitter, because I made the same points that you did in my list, and it was pretty striking, all the same points. And when you have, you know, basically we're thinking about this because we have the same backgrounds. We see the same things many times. So here's a quote from Carson Block. Green estimates when an incremental dollar is put to work with an active manager, it has an average effect on aggregate market capitalization of $2.50. The multiplier occurs because the number of shares available is smaller than the total number of shares outstanding. And a buyer must often pay a premium to induce a shareholder to sell. However, Green estimates that when a passive fund receives an additional dollar, the automatic decision to maintain balance by buying in proportion to market capitalization results in a market cap of $17, 17 to 1. It's all those themes that we've been talking about on Real Vision that are so important, the things that lurk beneath the surface, the structural issues, its leverage, its passive indexation costing, processional and feedback effects, its low rates, and it's the risk of bubbles. You know, the Mike Green analysis obviously is very sophisticated, but if you want the TLDR on passive indexation via Mike Green, it's this. If you're buying something because it's big, it's getting bigger because it's big. And that strikes me as something that can become really problematic.
Yeah. I would agree with that. And you know, before Jack wades in, let me just say that I talked to Katie Stockton yesterday, and she had four charts that she sent me. One of the four charts was the retail index. And the interesting bit was, this is the XRT ETF, is that if you look at the chart, it's relatively smooth. But then, you know, I'm looking at it right now. In late January, it just explodes higher and then like falls like a rock lower. Why? Because GameStop became a much bigger component of the ETF. And as a result of that, the people who were in the ETF had to buy more GameStop. So passive was actually amplifying the move up of GameStop. And then when it started to go down and GameStop actually became less of a component of the ETF, you know, they had to start selling GameStop too. So they were amplifying in both directions. Now think about that from the context of the S&P 500. If you get, you know, really big companies, Tesla as an example, you know, cratering 30% for whatever reason, that's going to have a huge impact in terms of amplification via this passive indexation.
Ed, I think that's such a good point. The GameStop scenario, that endgame, the saga we've been witnessing over the past few weeks, is an excellent example of the market dynamics that you get from passive investing and when the market is dominated by passive investing. Let's say that I am I'm BlackRock, or I'm a passive investment vehicle. People give me money and I allocate it to a specific market weighted index. And Ash, he's a shrewd guy. He's a hedge fund who, you know, makes the big bucks and is making the big calls. We both own GameStop, right? It's at $10. It goes to $300. Ash sells it because he obviously sees that the intrinsic value, wherever it is well below what the market is trading at, all the way up here. Me, I hold on to it because I don't care about valuation at all. All I want is for my own allocation, what's in the ETF or the fund, to match the index. And GameStop went from 0.02% of the index to 0.6%, or 30 times larger in terms of the share of market. And it briefly was actually the largest stock in the Russell 2000, larger than the fuel cell company. So that is exactly that. And when GameStop went in and people gave me more money, I actually had to buy more GameStop. But you're seeing the same dynamics going down. I think Ash, in conversation that Mike Green had with you, he used the phrase, the market has no brakes, but it's going uphill. So you can't see that the market has no brakes now, but if we ever reach a crest and things go down, I think that, you know, we could see that volatility go in the opposite way. It could go down as well.
Yeah. And by the way, let me just say that I know that GameStop has gotten crushed and they're down near $50 a share. AMC, because no one's talked about AMC, AMC is trading at $5.57 right now. So AMC is another one of these meme stocks that, you know, peaked at like 20. So that's a stock that's down 70%. Just imagine if you got in, you know, not at the top, but near the top. Let's say you got in at $15 a share. Now you're at $5.56. You could be sitting on losses for a very long time. So that's basically what I'm talking about in terms of, you know, where we are now. Some people, they think when the narrative for GameStop was that, you know, that we're crushing the big guy. But really, when you think about who's holding the bag, it's the people who came late to the party. Many of those people are going to be retail. And so going back to the IPO, I worry that these IPOs are going to start coming fast and furious. And that if you're not diversified across a large enough section to get the next Amazon, to get the next eBay or the next Facebook, then you are going to be decimated when some of these go to zero.
Absolutely. And Ed, I just want to draw a point of distinction because you mentioned AMC. With GameStop, you actually did have some retail traders on Wall Street Bets who did rip the faces off of the, you know, sophisticated hedge funds, Melvin Capital. As you actually did have the little guy win, although, you know, it's turning out now not great at all. But with the case of AMC, I think it's much more a stark example of you know, what can happen with the big investors benefiting. Because I think there were billions of dollars worth of debt that was held by well-heeled private equity firms that actually was paid off as AMC issued more equity because the stock was so high. And then they used that capital from the retail traders to pay to basically make the whales whole. So I think the dynamics there are really interesting. But you know, we've talked about IPOs. I want to switch it a little bit to SPACs or special purpose acquisition companies. I know Ash has had an upcoming interview with Mark Yusko, a friend of Real Vision. Ash, what did you learn in that interview?
Well, you know, it's an interesting interview. Obviously, Mark Yusko is encyclopedic about this. They've just created, he's just partnered to create a new ETF around SPACs. And effectively, you know, I asked him, are SPACs a bubble? Not surprisingly, he doesn't think they are a bubble. He's very passionate about the space. But he brings up some really interesting points about what SPACs are and how they work. Look, SPACs are a legal structure. SPACs are a mechanism for companies to raise money, like a direct listing or an IPO. It's an alternate mechanism. And Mark's point is that, look, you know, you can't blame a particular asset class or a particular structure. As money comes into a space, the good deals get done first. And then potentially, as something begins to heat up, it begins to look a little bit frothy. And other managers pile in to try and do theirs. It's a really interesting structure and something that you really do need a deep dive on. And I'd really recommend actually watching that interview if you want to understand a little bit about the structure, where the opportunities are, where the differences are from other mechanisms, and also, of course, what are the potential risks to investors?
You know, by the way, since you guys are both in New York, I wanted to ask you, are you investing in Alex Rodriguez's SPAC? You probably saw that A-Rod, he's got a SPAC. He's going to raise $500 million for his IPO. And he's a Yankee guy. So, you know, are you guys, are you on that bandwagon, the SPAC bandwagon?
I have yet to, I do own one or two SPACs. And perhaps some, you know, Real Vision super users will know what that is. But I'm not allocated in Alex Rodriguez's SPAC, nor do I own Paul Ryan's SPAC. I think there, you know, the fact that celebrities are attaching their names to these structures could be a sign of frothiness, and I say that somewhat understatedly. I want to know here the argument against. Sort of is this frothy is, hey, but Ed, but Ash, you say there are risks, but the worst thing that can happen is that investors get their $10 back. They, what do you say to that?
Well, I say that they're gonna, you know, if they invest in a company that's overvalued and then the value of that company is seen to be less, then I've lost my money.
Well, let me actually pick up on that, Jack, because it's a really important point. And this is why understanding these structures are so important, that getting back money at par is only for uninvested funds. So like if the SPAC gets created and then the deal doesn't get done, investors get their money back. But look, there's no such thing as a free lunch. Once SPACs get executed, I'm not sure what the exact legal language is, but once they're formed, you can certainly, to Ed's point, lose money on those companies. So this is definitely not a no loss proposition. Market forces always apply.
Yeah. So I think you, Jack, you were foreshadowing the thing that I like to talk about, credit markets. I think there are two parts to the credit markets today that I want to talk to. One is the corporate markets that you're interested in, and we can talk about that high yield in particular, but also I want to talk a little bit about the yield curve. And I know that Ash, she's interested in that. The reason I want to talk about it is because I talked to Katie Stockton yesterday. She's a technical analyst. Basically, if you think about just how Real Vision is, you know, we have the fundamental analysis, we have the macro. You know, she provides an aspect that we don't see from those guys, technical analysis. And of course, there's the political risk as well. You package those all up and you can get a complete picture. What she's saying about the treasury market right now is that if you look at certain indicators, technical analysis that she's done, that we've broken out to a new range above 1.00%. And there's resistance in that range from 1.0 all the way up to 1.5 at the 1.1425 level, meaning that from her perspective, if we close on Fridays, consecutive Fridays above that level, that's a suggestion that we are now moving towards the upper end of the range. We're out of the middle of the range and towards the upper end. And today we're at 1.20%, just as Ash said at the beginning of the broadcast. If that holds, which I believe it has, by the time this goes out, that means that it will be the second Friday in a row that we have been above that that resistance level. And by the way, this is the highest level that we've had since rates came plummeting down during the lockdown. So really, we're in a brave new world with regard to interest rates. Interest rates are going up, and they're at a level that we have not seen during the whole reflation trade thus far.
Interest rates are rising. The reflation narrative that we have, been anticipating, or market participants have been anticipating over the past few months, has seemed to come in the bond market, in that treasury yields have risen, and in the actual market, in that the banks are trading well, the energy companies are trading well. That kind of makes me think of your interview with Lynn Alden, which aired yesterday on Real Vision, where she did a deep dive on the types of companies that you want to own, according to whether inflation comes, according to whether the Fed enacts yield curve control. How was your outlook shaped at all, if at all, on the banks, on energy companies, and those sort of reflation trades by your interview with Lynn Alden?
You know, I mean, if I were to look at it from a bullish perspective, it would be that if you are not an inflationist, at a minimum, you could think that there's some real growth, meaning that if you're looking at nominal GDP, you're looking at it as more potential for real GDP growth versus a potential for inflation. Because when I look at the numbers, for instance, I was just reading Albert Edwards today. He was saying that, you know, last week that they had written about an upward surge in break evens. But when you actually look at the numbers, core CPI in China is tending towards 0%. You know, there was a plunge from 0.4% to a decline of 0.3% year over year in January. And then the same thing's happening in the United States, that there's no uptick really in core CPI. So when, if that's the case and reflation is there, then cyclicals like the ones that you talk about, the financials, et cetera, will benefit. That the steepness of the yield curve is going to benefit financials in particular. So you can think of that as real GDP growth bullish for those sectors, as opposed to bearish in the case of, you know, inflation robbing you of return.
And to precisely that point, at 30-year treasury yield now over 2%.
Yeah, that's another magic number that people are talking about. I thought it was interesting also that Howard Marks and Joel Greenblatt, where they were pounding the table for the U.S. to actually issuing 30-year, 50-year, even 100-year paper the way that Argentina has done. And there was one point that one of the two of them made that I thought was kind of interesting. I think it was Greenblatt. He was saying that when the yield curve is steepening the way that it is now, it almost causes people to want to take on debt at the short end, right? Because the difference between the short and the long end is so great. You're kind of like, you know, do I really want to play in the long end of the curve and lock in that rate when I could get this other rate that's lower? And ultimately, when rates shift up and they have to reinvest at a higher rate, that's when bad things happen. So to me, that's the essence of the credit cycle right there. If we see the yields go up and they stay up for a length of time, people who are reinvesting at those rates, they're suddenly going to say, wait a minute, I should have taken it out for 5 to 10 years. I shouldn't have taken it out for a year. Now I'm screwed. I may have to cut back on my CapEx or like fire people, et cetera.
We could talk about credit markets and the macro economy for a very long time, but so we can get our video editors to be able to have dinner with their families tonight, I teased at the outset something about crypto markets, and I just wanted to get this in. So last night, the first North American Bitcoin ETF was approved by regulators in Ottawa, Canadian regulators. This is the Purpose Bitcoin ETF. It trades on TSX. For those of you who may already be familiar with GBTC, which trades OTCQX over the counter, there's a difference in structure here, an ETF versus a closed end fund. ETFs are balanced continuously. It aims to replicate the price action more closely, especially when it's a single issue ETF. And I believe, although I haven't been able to confirm it, but I've heard there's also a dollarization option. Lots of Canadian ETFs have that as an option. And I believe it's present here, but we haven't been able to confirm it independently. There's also news coming out of Australia that regulators down under are open to a Bitcoin ETF. I guess you have to wonder how long till one comes in the United States. But even if it doesn't, if you have access to a brokerage account where you can get, where you can trade stocks that are listed on the TSX, you know, this is something that is coming. This is a greater degree of availability for Bitcoin through your brokerage account. Now, of course, there are people who are very passionate in the Bitcoin space who will say, "Not your keys, not your coins." But this is a big leap forward for people having access to products that can directly track the price of Bitcoin. Of course, there is a premium or a discount to net asset value with many closed-ended funds. This is something that we've seen if you follow GDPC on these exchanges today. But it is really an interesting moment. It's starting to feel like a pivotal moment also on the cryptocurrency side for this and a number of other reasons that we'll probably not have time to talk about here, but we do talk about all the time on Real Vision Crypto.
Ed, I have some thoughts, but do you want to go first? What do you think of that?
No, you know, I was thinking about you, that you that you're more in the crypto space. So I think that you could probably, you can, I'll pass the ball to you on this one.
Wow. Well, I'm definitely nowhere near as in the weeds as Ash is. He is a true insider, because I'm hearing not your coins made me laugh a little bit. I would say that it is bullish simply because it allows more money to come into the space. And as investors, institutional investors, give money to these funds have to buy more Bitcoin. And that drives the price up. And it pretty much is as simple as that.
Yeah, that's back to our previous conversation. By the way, one note that I wanted to make when I heard you guys talking about ETFs earlier, there's a Swiss chemist, late Swiss chemist by the name of Albert Hofmann. If that name may sound familiar to you, it's because he was the inventor of a drug called LSD. And at the end of his life, he lived to be like 101 years old. And near the end of his life, he wrote an autobiography and he called it My Problem Child. About LSD and the things that had taken on in the culture with the drug that he'd created in the lab. I was just thinking that similarly, the father of the ETF, Jack Bogle, a Wall Street legend, toward the end of his life had some misgivings about what had happened with his problem child, the exchange-traded fund. So if you want to get some interesting information there, Google Jack Bogle and ETF for a really interesting story.
That's so funny you say that, Ash. I actually didn't think you'd say Jack Bogle, although that's a good point. I thought you were going to say the founder of Dogecoin, who founded this thing. He was into cryptocurrency, into freedom, and now he realizes that this thing has been bid up, so it has $8 billion market cap? You know, Albert Hofmann, I believe he discovered LSD because he made it in the lab, and then he wanted it to do some purpose, some industrial purpose. It didn't do it. He was disappointed. He put it in his pocket, and he biked home. But it sort of slid down his leg or something like that. And he sort of had the effect of LSD on the bike. So I wonder if the founder of Dogecoin is riding his bike and just sort of, what are these traders doing? Ash and Ed, what do you make of this, of Dogecoin and Elon Musk's pumping of it, if I can use that word?
Ash, it's all you, buddy.
Listen, I'll just say this about Dogecoin. The single most important fact to know about Dogecoin was it was created as a joke. And now it has a market capitalization. I'm looking at $9.1 billion. To me, That looks a little frothy. Who knows? Is it possible that with all the money coming into the space that it will attract new developers, they'll do new things with it? It kind of the GameStop story that we were talking about. What could potentially happen that could be good for GameStop? GameStop becomes an online, the Netflix of gaming. So is it possible? I'm not saying that, you know, that Dogecoin is necessarily going to massively implode. It's always possible in this space. You never want to say never. But look, when something is founded as a joke, if I created Ashcoin, you know, because of something that we were having a conversation about when we were out drinking beers, and you woke up one morning and it was trading at $9 billion market cap, you'd probably sell some.
Well, to finish this conversation off and finish our RVDB off, Ash, I don't think you know this, but Jack and I, we are starting a SPAC. He and I, we've decided that we are going to have a SPAC, and the investment in this SPAC is going to be, we're only going to buy when the market is down. So we're going to, it's called, you know, buy at the bottom, you know, sell at the top. That's our SPAC. So get ready.
Yeah. And I actually think that unironically, that is a good investment strategy. If we were real investment managers, the problem would be, though, people would give us money. We'd hold it as cash and get no return on it. And then, you know, Joe Schmo, hedge fund manager, would be having 30% returns because he's been investing in Tesla. He's been investing in, you know, in hydrogen fuel cells and stuff like that. And we wouldn't have any returns. So the investors would pull our money. And I think that that is happening.
Exactly. And that's the best. That's the best outcome, right? Because we're not going to invest when it's, we're telling them, look, your money, we're not going to invest it until things go down, and we can scoop it up, you know, on the value. And if they can't wait, if, you know, things rage forward, then they get their money back. Good for them. Then they can reallocate it. But if things fall, then they're going to profit because they were with us.
And I think if you can put 3x leverage in it, you might have a product. Guys, as we get to the end here, final thoughts.
I think, you know, we are in uncharted territory in certain ways. I think when we keep hedging our bets, when we say, you know, hey, look, you know, Dogecoin, anything can happen. I think it's a sign that the market has accelerated in a way that makes us uncomfortable. We're uncomfortable making predictions based upon that because a lot of this is trading on momentum. My hope is that we can have a period of consolidation, and things can trade more on fundamentals rather than momentum going forward.
Mm. Jack, final thoughts.
That's interesting. Well, it's not so much of a thought, more of an observation. I was reading a newsletter on credit, and about $855 billion worth of junk corporate debt is now trading under 4%. That's about 58% of the entire speculative grade market in the US. And I think it is a result of the dynamics that we've been talking about. As yields are so low, investors have to reach out to buy more investment grade. They go up the risk curve, but then that gets, you know, that increases in price. So then they have to buy high yield. Ash, I know Raoul has talked about you with this in the crypto world with regards to altcoins. And I think the dominant view is that rates will rise in the market. So I think that people are going to sort of floating rate products like bank loans and other such things. And I don't know. I don't know how this can, I'm agnostic about whether this time is different, but I have reason to believe that this can't last forever. And there could be some sort of chink in the armor. Now, when that comes, I don't know. Ash and Ed, what do you think about that? What are your final thoughts?
I agree. I think that we're living in unprecedented times, and there are lots of risks out there. But, you know, as Chuck Prince said, people are saying, look, you know, when the music's playing, we're going to dance, and they're dancing.
Chuck Prince at Citigroup, you know, one of the great crisis bubble indicator statements. I've said this before, but it's worth saying again for people, especially on the crypto side. Obviously, things are really hot right now in Bitcoin and other digital assets. If you're interested in this space, particularly if you're a young person who's just getting interested in investment in the first time, invest, but invest your time. Understand what these products are, understand what they do, learn about the technology, spend less time worrying about every tick on the price and learn a little bit about what's happening underneath the hood in the long term that will absolutely benefit you.
Absolutely. And Ash, if I may, I think a great way to do that is to watch Real Vision content. We've got some of the best investors in the world who we've been speaking to. You know, I mean, Lynn Alden, Howard Marks, Joel Greenblatt. But that's just been this week and Russell Napier. But next week, we've got Tom Steyer, Julian Brigden is coming on, Lacey Hunt, Felix Zuloff is talking to Raul. So, you know, and Mark Yusko. And then the following week, we have a few special guests, which I'll won't say. But the final thing I'll say is that, you know, if you're not a member of Real Vision and you want access to these interviews, you can click the link below and you can sign up for just a dollar. So I think this is the best opportunity that I think exists out there.
Yeah, Jack, to pick up on that point on the crypto side, obviously we have some of the best investors on, but we also have some of the smartest technologists. And I think that's something that's really cool about the platform, something that we did last week. Just to give you an example, an interview with Yehuda Lindell, who is an Israeli academic cryptographer. And he came on the platform and actually explained in terms that ordinary people could understand elliptical curve cryptography over finite fields. This is the wonkiest of the math, but we think it's really important, again, to pick up on the point that I was making earlier, not just about focusing on the tick by tick, but understanding the math, the computer science, the things that exist underneath the surface that people aren't paying attention to in the space. And this is so important. And this is what generates the opportunity to really become someone who understands this space.
Absolutely. And apologize. Apologies to everyone, our members who are sort of rolling their eyes for us patting our backs or beating our chests. But the thing is, you know, Ed, Ash and I, we're Real Vision members too, and we're viewers too. We want to watch this content, so we can't help but be so excited about it. So if you're not a Real Vision member, please sign up now and get these things. And if you are a Real Vision member, enjoy the next 2 weeks, as I know you will.
It sounds like a PBS telethon. I feel like I should send them a Channel 13 tote bag when we finish here. But by the way, I should just add to pick up on that. Real Vision Crypto, completely free, not a trial. Just come and sign up. All you need to do is give us your email address. All of the content, absolutely free, not a trial. And you can get access to everything that we've been talking about on the crypto side.
Well said. And guys, have a great weekend. It was a pleasure, as always, talking to you. Sorry I didn't get to talk more junk with you. But next week, we'll try that.
And also, come on the platform. We know that you're covering in-depth the credit markets, and you're doing some of the smartest analysis and best interviews anywhere out there.
Thanks very much.
Thanks, everyone, for joining us. Have a good weekend.